Good evening and welcome to the Thursday, March 23rd, 2017 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Markowitz and I am chairing the meeting, and I'll start by asking the clerk to call the roll of the school committee.
Dr. Thomas Barrett?
Here.
Ms. Molly
Byrne? Here.
Ms. Rebecca
present.
Ms. Laura Fowle?
Present.
Ms. Anthony?
Present.
Ms. Dan
Myers? Present.
Mr. Howard Moore?
Here.
Mr. Nett Reed?
Here.
Mr. Edgar
present.
And Mayor David
present. Okay, tonight's meeting, which is one of our extra meetings that we hold during the month of February and March, is for the purpose of continuing discussions and possible vote on the FY2018 budget. But we will begin, as usual, with public comment period. I have a sign-up sheet that folks have signed up to speak. And I would just ask that when you come to the podium, you state your name and address for the record, and then I would ask you to please honor the 3-minute time limit. So the first person who has signed up to speak is Mary Cowie.
Good evening. My name is Mary Cowie, and these are my colleagues, educational support professionals, Maria De La Vega, Karen Cipolletti, Joan Morvidelli, and Marilyn Rivera, who I just want to point out, when I started as a teacher at Jackson Street Elementary School in 1997, Marilyn Rivera was my first ESP and taught me so much that I needed to know. We teach at Jackson Street School and Bridge Street School, and formerly Jackson Street School. And I am speaking tonight as a member of the Northampton Association of School Employees, NACE, on behalf of my fellow union members. We would like to address one aspect of the budget process in the hope that school committee and administration can learn from mistakes made this time around. Administrators read Dr. Provost's letter at faculty meetings February 6th and planned to announce it to ESPs the following day, which was further delayed by a snow day. As faculty, we were told not to discuss it, apparently so that we wouldn't upset the ESPs who would be notified later of the first view proposed large staff reduction. We are here tonight to say that it was disrespectful and divisive to give teachers the information first and tell them to withhold it from ESPs, their fellow union members. As you're aware, a prominent feature of the negotiations and contract that NACE ratified on January 10th was that teachers made sacrifices in order to raise the floor to increase wages and benefits for our union brothers and sisters, many of whom work every day as ESPs and mostly earn $16,000 to $21,000 a year before deductions, working up to 28 years for the Northampton Public Schools. We did that, made the decision to raise the floor, because we respect and value our fellow union members. When administration wants to share significant news, they should deliver it to all educators, teachers, and ESPs together simultaneously. Northampton Association of School Employees is one union, and we stand in solidarity with all of our members, educational support professionals, teachers, clerical, janitorial, food service, and transportation. In the future, we will speak freely with fellow union members about news affecting us as soon as we learn it. NACE is one union, and we will not be divided. Thank you.
The next person signed up to speak is Andrea James.
Good evening.
My name is Andrea James, and I live at 67 Beacon Street in Florence, and I am a world language teacher and the department chair here at JFK Middle School. I'm here tonight representing Ms. Wilson, who could not make it, and my department. Thank you for your hard work in preparing next year's budget options and for all the time that you put into your school committee responsibilities, especially the late nights. To me, 7:24 is a late night. Despite the fact that I and other JFK and world language community members have already written to you asking you to not eliminate the sixth grade world language program, I felt I needed to speak tonight as well. I would never forgive myself if the remaining tiny piece of the FLES program, which stands for Foreign Language Elementary School Program, which was a grade 3 through 6 program, in which has been a part of this school system for about 40 years, and where I started my career. I'd hate it if it ended because I didn't stand up at this podium again. I know you've read the letters that I and Ms. Wilson and my other colleagues have written to you, and I appreciate that. I just wanted to add a tiny bit of data to the mix. Yesterday and today, I observed my UMass student teaching intern as she taught the first 2 days of Block 5 of sixth grade French. The majority of the class was conducted in French, and over the 2 days, the students learned and could either pronounce beautifully and or comprehend accurately at least 50 words in just 2 days. And that's with also explaining the evacuation procedure in English, where the bathroom is in English, and our lockdown procedure. So 50 words in just 2 days. I'm still, after all these years, amazed that how quickly they learn when they're at the age of 11 and 12. They just pick it up so quickly. And I think it would be a pity to waste the opportunity for them to learn a second or even third language when they are so ripe to do so. Thank you for strongly considering budget options that do not impact the sixth grade world language program at JFK.
The next person who has signed up to speak is Jeremy Whalen.
Hello, Jeremy Whalen, 214 Pomeroy Lane, Amherst, Massachusetts, and a technology teacher at Northampton High School. We recently just got back from the Model UN conference at UMass, and I wanted to congratulate 4 of our students out of our 10 delegation. I believe there's about 200 students received awards, so this is the highest awarded delegation that we've brought. So, congratulations to them. This weekend we're going to be going to Smithfield, Rhode Island for the Devil Bots first competition. We did terrific last time. We had a rough first going. They really turned it around. We have a young team. They placed 17th out of 42 teams. And they made the playoffs, which was really good. It was a really good boost, and we made a lot of improvements. We're there over, at Smith Volk right now, making the final adjustments for, and we leave tomorrow. So good luck to them as well. I want to, and also to Todd Currier, the head coach of the robotics team. He won the Woody Flowers Finalist Award, and that's the students actually nominated him for his great volunteering and everything that he does for our team. So he actually won that at our district competition. So that was a really great honor for Todd, and I congratulate him on that as well. Thank you to Night Owl Tattoo. They actually, it was a small donation, $160, which got us 16 tripods for the for our classes. Those tripods are something that we desperately needed, and the local businesses, Night Owl is a local business, they came through when we needed them. So thank you to them. Today we sent out a survey about detailing a new website redesign for the district. I'm really excited about that. I'm actually doing that through as my master's thesis at UMass in the Learning Media and Technology program in the College of Education, and I've been working with Dr. Provost. as well as Molly McLaughlin, the digital literacy and computer science coordinator. So really excited about that. You should see an email to review that, and I would love your input and feedback on that. The last thing is, we created last semester, but finally printed it. We will be having a donation of books to all the elementary schools that was produced and self-published by my semester one photography class. We actually were learning a specific element of Photoshop, and it kind of the project took off. And it's actually a great story. It's a story about a young girl who has to flee her home and find solace in a new community, accepting community. And the students did this themselves, took the initiative on it, completed it. And I'm really proud of them, especially in light of kind of recent news and events, to take initiative into to produce this. So thank you all very much.
Thank you, Jeremy. The next person who has signed up to speak is Garrett Adams.
Hi, I'm Garrett Adams, and I am a teacher, ESL teacher at Bridge Street School, Jackson Street School. I teach the youngest children in kindergarten, first and second grade. I'm a former preschool teacher at Clark School for the Deaf, working in the integrated preschool program. And I know I've said those to you before, but for our audience at home, to explain where I'm coming from. And I feel a little self-conscious about my button, but I realized that it says we are all educators. Thank you to my educators. But it really is not like a political statement. It's not a teaching philosophy. It's my philosophy of life. We're all learners, we're all educators. We teach each other and we learn from each other. And we really can only do that if we're together. So I really, really appreciate so much of the work that has gone on in the last couple of years. And I feel like we're growing to a place of really working together and really listening to each other. This process, I think, has been addressed, how short it was and how little information that was given by people who perhaps have the most experience. And hopefully that can be addressed. But we're making a budget decision. My question really is, do we want fewer adults in our elementary schools? Do we think we can do a better job than we're doing now and include more children with fewer adults? And a companion piece to this is the big picture. All is all. Inclusion is everyone. And inclusion of all students and inclusion of all educators is two sides of the same coin. Equal rights for all students and equal respect for all educators is two sides of the same coin. So I really think from an economic perspective, from a valuable perspective, to use the people that we have and train them and motivate them. This is the result of a process that really is a process. I'm holding up the QSORT community meetings. Thousands of people were talked to, they were invited, they were solicited, and we're all on the same page in Northampton. We all want the same things. So I urge you to take time with this, and thank you. Do the best that you can do.
Thank you. So that completes the list of folks who've signed up to speak. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak during the public comment period? Okay, so hearing none, I will now move into period for announcements from the school committee. Are there any announcements? Dr. Baird.
Yes. So I regret to announce that I'll be resigning from the school committee after we approve our budget for next year. As many of you know, I started a new job last July, which increased my already lengthy commute. So in order to have a better work and family balance, we're going to move to Connecticut. It's been an honor to serve on the Northampton School Committee, and I wish you all the best.
Is there anyone else who has any announcements to make from the school committee? Ms. Fallon.
Just a reminder that next Wednesday, March 29th at 6 p.m. is the 17th annual NEF Adult Spelling Bee. It's probably too late to sign up, but it's not too late to come and cheer us on. Dinner will be served starting at 5 for those who are interested. So that's it.
Any other announcements? Okay. So we'll now move into the reports and recommendations. It's to continue our discussion of the FY 2018 budget. And for that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Provost and
Thank you. The first order of business is a little bit of housekeeping, which I will explain, and then we'll move through that, and then I'll talk some more about the budget. So we left the last meeting with the charge to continue being engaged in being open to modifications to the plan, as well as trying to flesh out the plan so that people can understand it better. We do have one modification. It's a slight modification. I think it's probably the last one for this budget cycle. There was a request from the Jackson Street principal to move slightly back towards the original WINS proposal by reducing two ESPs and $10,000 worth of materials and supplies in order to add another teacher back into the model. So that's only three positions altogether and a $10,000 reduction in one of the line items. But many of these tabs, many of these tables populate other tables. So there are a lot of pages that need to be adjusted in the budget book. So I would turn it over to Candy to walk us through our piles. I'd point out that we have two recycling bins, so we'll be able to throw our old pages out. But we need to pay attention to her so we can get our new pages in the right position.
It's not quite that much to throw out. But the other option, if you prefer, is just put a line through the old one and insert your new one in front if you'd rather do that. So you can make a comparison later, but we can walk through it. So the first batch is in tab one. First page is okay. There's a change on the second page, the projected FY18 budget by cost center. The change we're going to talk about tonight had an impact on the Jackson budget and the special ed budget, so those two cost centers changed. So you've got a new page there. Right behind that is a related sheet that basically is the same numbers with a pie chart showing you what percentage each of the cost centers represents. The next sheet is not a change. The changes we made were so small that it did not change the percentages on the major budget areas, so that sheet will remain. Behind that is your Department of Ed, the budget by Department of Ed function code. So there were some minor, very minor changes to the percentages, but we thought we would give you a new chart for that. Next few sheets have no changes. The summary of the budget changes and the proposed substitute rates have no changes. Behind that, you have five pages that are color-coded for the various budget versions. Again, all five of those pages are changing. Minor, but they're changing.
Be fascinating for the audience.
Yeah. That's where the juggler is supposed to come in and entertain the audience.
We're usually pretty paperless. This is like the exception.
And the last page in that section of tab one, the summary of all funds, also has some minor changes, so we've given you a new one.
Okay.
Next week, we move on to tab two. There's a new sheet here, which is not a replacement. The one that says modifications to the WINS budget model changes from March 9th to March 23rd is a new page. I suggest putting it behind page two in that section. And page four, which is the Jackson Street, four proposals for Jackson Street. You have a new one for those because of the modification in mod wins to speak about tonight. Then we're going to go to tab four, which is Jackson Street's budget. The narrative profile remains the same. Behind that, you have one page of FTEs and two pages of money. All three of those pages are being replaced. Next section is tab 10, student services. Again, the narrative is remaining the same. Behind that, you have several pages of FTE, several pages of budget, and then a special ed tuition history. All of that section is being replaced.
So, Katie, everything to tab 11, just take it out.
All of tab 10.
Tab 10, everything after the narrative.
Yep.
And tab 10 will come out. Last page, Laura's done, it's erased. Last section is tab 13, page four, which is your school choice budget. Has a change on it, so you have a new page there.
Can you give us that last one again, please?
13, tab 13.
Page four.
The school choice. Yeah,
budget. School choice.
Thanks.
Next, I'd like to bring the committee up to date and the public up to date on totals of the public comment. This is written public comment. Just for the public, the committee has the complete original, so these are just the tallies that summarize the package that they have. So to date, we have 32 responses in favor of the WINS or modified WINS proposal. 7 opposed to the WINS or modified WINS proposal. We have 2 that said we like the original WIN proposal, not the modified WIN proposal, don't make any changes. We had 1 in favor of the alt cut, 4 opposed to the alt cut. We had 1 alternative proposal submitted, that was the icons. We had 9 that were really just clarifying questions without expressing a preference. There was 1 response that was, in a sense, kind of a new model. It was requesting that we replicate the kindergarten model in the first grade. There was 1 comment to restore the high school tech position. There were three, I believe I have one here, but I believe there were three concerns about librarian cuts. There was one request for a multi-year rollout, and there was one that was officially taking no stance. So that's the update on the feedback. Next, I have one more piece for us to insert in our books.
That's a question about the feedback.
Sure.
So was there any, from what we've read, but do you recall anybody saying we should reduce further or we need to keep our taxes low, please don't raise our taxes?
There was still none of those. Okay, so let me give you this to put in your book and I'll just walk you through this. This package could go in tab two, right at the beginning of tab two, in front of the Modwins proposal. It's really more information explaining the Modwins proposal. Should say the Modwins proposal as modified again tonight.
Repeat that, please. Ed was distracting us.
It's okay. This is tab two, right at the beginning of tab two.
Thanks, Fallon.
It's before that. Right there.
Thank you.
So, what we attempted to do in this is show what the classrooms would actually look like next year in terms of students and teachers, and we listed students as three types. General ed students, these are non-eligible students, kids who don't qualify for any type of special education. And then we have a second column called special ed, formerly in program. So these are the students who we're talking about including as a part of this budget. And then third column, special ed, who are students who already included this year. And then on the far right-hand column, you can see the teaching configuration for those set of classes. So there's a lot of detail here, and I'm not going to walk through everyone, but I did want to give sort of a summary of overall what it shows. So you'll see that no classroom, and I should say that these are hypothetical. Things may change based on who enrolls and who unenrolls. But in terms of students who are currently in programs, I did have conversations with principals about where they would be likely to place the students. So those hypothetical placements are pretty close to what I expect them to be next year. So you'll see that no classroom is likely to receive more than three students from the substantially separate programs, and all but one of those will be a co-taught classroom. There is one classroom that has nine students with disabilities. That would be the co-taught classroom at grade five in Bridge Street School. That's sort of the outlier in the whole model. The average number of students with disabilities in co-taught classrooms would be five. In team-taught classrooms, including the class size capped classrooms at Bridge, the average number of students with disabilities would be 3.4. The average caseload for general ed teachers would be three or four students with disabilities and 15 typical students. Elementary special ed teachers would be responsible both for the progress of students with disabilities and typical peers in the classroom, but we know the paperwork issues that people bring up around special education are related specifically to their eligible students. So the average caseload for a special educator would be about eight students. So these are really great ratios. This is really setting the table, I think, for success, both for students and teachers. And I think when you look at the program this way, you see the power of what we're proposing to do. I think it's also important to say, and it's too bad that some of the ESPs who spoke at the beginning left, but I had said that it's likely in the modified WINS proposal that we'd be able to make the changes that we need to make without having to do any layoffs. As of this morning, we have already received a sufficient number of ESPs, resignations, or planned retirements so that we don't project that there would be any ESP layoffs. So I just wanted to put that out there. I think those are the key pieces. I think, you know, there's no new information to share other than to say that this information will go on the website tomorrow, and I really would encourage people to take a look at actual class configurations, because I think you'll see they're really quite favorable.
So are there questions, discussion about the new information we received tonight? Any feedback? Ms. Fallon?
So, for example, looking at the leads under the special ed former program, it's zero all the way down. So are you saying that really there's no change in the composition of the class, but there will be an additional teacher?
In leads, yes. The assumption that we're going with here is that students who have been placed in a school other than their home school would likely stay. We don't know if that's the case. What we've said all along is that if students wanted to return to their home school, they could. So if that happens, there may be some former program students in leads. But for now, the only potential, you know, students we might have otherwise called program students would be in the kindergarten.
So the only thing that's changing is you'll have more teachers for the same students that we are already educating. Like an additional special education teacher.
Well, there will be, at Leeds, I think they go up, I want to say, two special ed teachers and down 1.5 ESPs. So there is a reduction of ESPs, but I do want to acknowledge that. It's not just additions, but there are more teachers.
Sorry, so you expect, like, for instance, Leeds having zero and then Bridge Street having a few more that were formerly in programs, you expect those numbers to kind of sort themselves out over the years as students start and stay in their home school?
Yes. So you'll see the outlier class that I mentioned is the one at Bridge. That's in part, you know, either the intended or unintended consequence of moving many of the special education programs to the school has resulted in the largest imbalance in terms of students with disabilities being there. But under the model with students being able to remain in their home school, I would expect over the course of the next 5 years, you'd see an overall reduction in the number of students with disabilities at Bridge Street, including students who would formerly be in substantially separate programs, and probably an increase at Leeds.
Thank you.
Yes.
I wish that I had this on my fingertips, but I'm just curious. At this time at Bridge, what is the largest class size that they have? And this question actually is yeah, right now. I see it on this chart.
You actually do have it at your fingertips.
I know that I do. I just couldn't find it, and I thought maybe you could just say it.
Yes.
Me flipping through.
So largest class size at Bridge currently is 20 students.
Is 20. So, you know, I guess, like, you know, one of the concerns that I'm sure you can address, or the principal from Bridge, is that space issue of classrooms and navigating having more kids in, you know, a same size, and how that affects, and to, you know, adults as well, how that.
So once again, I wish I had included the picture of the classroom here, but we did have, I did ask Principal Choquette to set up a classroom with 27 desks to see what it would look like, just to see if there would be still teaching space and reasonable learning spaces, and there was. In this model, we don't get to 27. The highest we get to is 25, which is 5 more than the current largest class size. But
it's with two teachers.
Pardon?
But it's with two teachers, so.
Yeah. We do have Principal Chiquette here.
Yeah.
Looks like she might have something to say.
Do you have something to say about sort of fitting all those kids in?
Do I need to go to the mic?
I think so. Sorry.
So we would be shuffling classrooms around because at Bridge there are classrooms that are smaller and then we have rooms that are much larger. So it'll be a busy summer because I'll take a look at the classroom, the rooms themselves at the sizes and see which class would benefit from obviously having a larger space and which ones would be better in the smaller spaces. So we would be doing a lot of shuffling around. Custodians already came to me and said, I'm going to be busy this summer, aren't I? I said, yes, if it goes through. So
great.
Yep.
I mean, and in a model like this, I mean, it feels like also that we can begin to, you know, also move away from desk and chair all the time. And I certainly know that standing desks are, I have a standing desk myself.
That's the other thing I wanted to say, you know, with this model, it's not just about adding more kids and adding more teachers. We really have to look at how we set up our classrooms to make it truly a space for co-teaching. It's not the traditional model of desks and rows. It's really about looking at different areas in the classroom and kind of doing away with desks and maybe having tables as centers and really looking at how we set up the actual physical space.
Yeah, I think that that's a really great conversation to have and how the curriculum that we have also adheres to that sort of model, and we haven't had a chance to talk about it because we've been so wrapped up in the numbers. So, you know, I think that that's a very comfortable thing for parents to hear.
Dr. Bear.
So can we talk a little bit about the professional development for teachers and planning time, co-planning time? And so I'm curious as to whether or not schedules have been developed yet, that we know that teachers are going to have co-planning time with their cooperating teacher. And I know that Nancy sent out some ideas around professional development. I guess my big concern is with professional development next year slated for the new math program, and with the limited number of hours of professional development in the contract, how are we going to accomplish professional development that is ensures equity, everyone's getting it, everybody's getting what they need? Because I feel like that it seemed like a lot of the professional development was, they'll be optional, it'll be there, people can sign up for it if they want to. Can you talk about both those things?
Sure. I think the optional piece actually bleeds into both, because when you have a co-taught situation, what you also have are co-scheduled duty-free preps. The duty-free preps are duty-free. You can't mandate co-planning during those times. But I do think that a lot of teachers will avail themselves of that opportunity. The reason I think they will is because I know that principals have already, in many cases, developed schedules that allow for grade-level teams to have the same time off, and lots of times the teachers work with each other during that time. So, and if you're in a team teaching situation, it's really just a matter of adding a third person to the team. The other thing I would point out is that the TA includes a lot of additional days for teacher work days, which don't exist in the current schedule. We actually started sort of implementing the spirit of the contract in January to provide those. So again, those are days where we can't mandate that teachers will use the time for co-planning, but my expectation would be that if the teachers feel that that's what they need to use the time for, that's what they will use the time for. In terms of professional development, you've all seen the schedule of both mandatory and or voluntary professional development that we plan to provide with this. I think one of the things that is really important to talk about is the training the teachers already bring to the table. Special educators have a degree in modifying curriculum and making accommodations for students with disabilities. That's really their strong suit. And so a great deal of what I see as the professional development that's going to occur in this model is the two teachers actually working with each other, and the special ed teacher showing the general ed teacher how to make accommodations, how to run behavior plans, how to meet the needs of kids that they maybe didn't have exposure to in their background. And on the other hand, the classroom teachers getting the special ed teachers much more grounded in the curriculum of a specific grade level. So I think that kind of professional development is not, you know, typically what we think of as, you know, PD, but it does conform to what we know about job-embedded type of learning being much more effective than one-time trainings. So that's how I see the professional development rolling out in this. And I'll just speak from my experience as someone who's done inclusion programs in other districts where we have, as I said, we did 4 days. Here we have the opportunity to do 2 days. But really what the teachers found to be most helpful was actually just doing it and working with each other. So that's what I have to say about professional development. We will continue to provide support. My expectation is that the teachers who feel sort of most uncomfortable about this will take most advantage of the voluntary trainings, and that some who feel like they're ready to go probably won't participate in those voluntary trainings as much. But everyone is going to grow. It's going to be a developmental journey for everyone, and I think it's important that we start with that sort of growth mindset in mind. This is going to be a learning process for all. As Mr. Adams said, we're all teachers, we're all learners, and that certainly will be playing out as we implement this model.
Other questions, other comments about the budget?
So I just wanted to, I guess maybe it's more of a comment less than a question, but I just wanted to talk about the librarians for a moment, because the letters that we received really resonated with me with this idea that I think there's like there's necessary fallout. I understand this, you know, this is a budgetary decision as much as it is anything else, but I think it is too soon to say that this experiment didn't work with librarians, and that, you know, in a you know, when that day comes and the fair share tax passes and we have a whole different budget that we're dealing with, that I'd like to just leave it open that we would revisit that, because I think we're two-thirds of the way through this. You know, we haven't finished the school year. It's too, I can't imagine we really could determine that they didn't have a, you know, really positive impact given everything we know about the potential they'd have to bring to the table and how it often takes a couple of years to roll something out. So I just wanted to add that to the conversation.
I guess I'll have a question too.
Sure.
It's about following up on PD. I'm assuming because of budget constraints that even I'm really concerned that we're asking teachers to do more and we're not providing them with support. And the support in the form of somebody, if we're saying, please differentiate this classroom or please modify your lesson plan, the teachers are already maxed out. Who's going to help them do that? And the research shows that the way you get that movement is through support for teachers in the form of, you know, peer reviewing and coaching and all kinds of things that don't cost a lot of money, but they cost a little bit more money. And if you spend that little bit more money, you go from 5% transfer of PD to 95% transfer of PD. And so I don't know if this is a question or a speech, but it just really concerns me that we're asking so much of teachers ordinarily. Now we're asking even more of teachers, and we're not giving them the people who are master teachers or mentors or coaches or whatever to say, here, let me help you do this. Let me help you put materials together for your next class so that we can differentiate this classroom. And it just really bothers me that we can't find this relatively small amount of money that would have such a big impact from 5% to 95%, according to the research.
Well, I guess I would want to respond to one piece of that, which is we're trying to create a situation where teachers are not alone in their classrooms anymore. You know, that's really what we heard, what I heard anyways, when the question was posed to me at that meeting in late January. And so we're putting forward a model where a teacher will have the support of another teacher for the whole day or for half of the day, or in sort of the lowest contact time case, 2 hours a day, which is something they don't have now. So I think that's, and it's going to be a teacher who brings a different set of expertise. So I do think that it's an attempt to move in that direction. We also are doing, adding a coach for ELA, so they'll have that support. So, you know, step by step, we're moving in that direction. I think this provides more support than currently exists. And I think this support we're adding outweighs the additional burden we're placing when you look at what these actual class sizes look like. You know, you're in some cases not even changing the class composition at all and getting a special educator for half a day. That, to me, I think that that's a good trade for teachers.
I don't mean to sound like I'm criticizing the change that you're making. I think it's fabulous, and I really appreciate everything you've done with this and how you've gone about it and how inclusive you've been. What I'm bemoaning is that we are only given a pie of a certain size, and that as a result, we can't provide the support that teachers really require and that research shows helps them get to that next level. And it just bothers me. And I think it's important to go on the record as saying that this is an insufficient amount of money that we have here, because we're not able to spend a little bit more and give the teachers the support that other districts have that allows them to really push to another level and really by supporting teachers. So I love what you're doing. I hate the bind that we're in financially.
I like the mod wins, I'll say that. But and I agree with Ms. Brzezinski. The parts that make me sad, I actually think the librarians were working. I think what I've seen done at Jackson Street and what I've heard is being done at other schools, the elementary school level has been incredibly important. So that makes me sad. I do think that this model of inclusion is, and I've said this, it's the way we need to move. I think it is a civil rights issue. I think it will be transformative to our district. Exclamation point. I love that. The problem I have, and it's nothing that you can do, is it's that it's in this context, I feel like within this budget context, that of course we want more ESPs. Of course we want the librarians. Of course we want more PD for our teachers. Of course we want $20,000 for supplies for Jackson Street School. But we're fighting over crumbs in education in our country. And so that's actually the context we're talking about. And all these things that people talk about are actually what we want. And so I believe that, you know, we need librarians, and we need, the ESPs are incredibly valuable to our children and to our teachers. So I love the mod wins. I love the direction we're going to, but we have to be really honest about where our state is, what we're funding in our country, and our priorities. I mean, a budget is a moral document, and this is a moral statement, what we're saying about inclusion, and yet our country and our state is making a very different moral statement about how we're valuing education. So I love what you're doing within the context. I think, Mayor Narkowitz, what you've done in terms of what the city gives to education is profound and wonderful. We're just bound in a bad way. And so I love this, and I thank you for it. Those are my statements.
Mr. Meyer.
Well, since a lot of times these programmatic changes come up around budget time, because that's when decisions are made about resources, and there's always the suspicion that, you know, you're trying to solve your budget problem by changing programs. And I just, you know, thinking about the numbers, I just want to point out that the growth rate for a teacher's salary is higher than the growth rate for ESP salaries. So, you know, if you were trying to do this on the cheap, this is not the way you would do it. This is truly about changing a model. And of course, changing a model while schools are still operating, you don't have the luxury of shutting down for 3 years. You can't retool like an auto plant. And so you will learn as you go. And I think that being honest about that is the best way to make a program like this work.
I would just like to say that I appreciate, I mean, what Anne said, thank you, and I think that we're all with you on that. I really also wanted to say that the superintendent brought up something important when he brought up growth mindset, and change is really hard. Change is really, really scary, and it's really hard, and we ask our kids to do it every single day when they show up at school, and we ask them to have a growth mindset every single day, and I think we all know that that's not always easy for them. I am struck by my different feelings of like, yes, this is right, and this is really hard for teachers, and I really understand that. And at the same time, we have such extraordinary teachers that I also am like, I know it's a lot to ask of them, and I also know that they can do it. And I know that what Nat said about all of the things that they are going through and how hard it is, and I know that that piles up on them, and I really hope that if this is the direction that we really want to go in, that the teachers will give themselves that break and let themselves be a part of the growth mindset and let themselves know that as a community, we know how hard they work and we'll support them through this. And I think as a community, we really do need to support them during this, if this is the move that we go in. And one of the things that I particularly love about this is that I think that it puts the community of children above a lot of other stuff. And I think that that community of children is what I am passionate about in our Northampton schools. And I think that for our kids, what I've always said is that I love my kids being with all of these kids. That is what I love. Yes, I love investigations and I love the writing curriculum, but I love my kids being with these kids, with all of the kids, all of them, everybody. So I really hope that the teachers can know that the community supports them during this time, and that they, you know, that they'll get, you know, they might not have it, but they will, like yet, right? Not yet, but they will have it.
Ms. Fenn.
Yeah, I think I was really gonna echo what Mr. Meyer and Ms. Burnham had said was, you know, this is a big change, and I'm sure we're gonna make mistakes and we're gonna rectify them, that we'll make plans and we'll change them. And I hope that everyone just has faith that we're doing the right thing for the right reasons and we'll figure it out. And that they can, like, I've been so appreciative of the thoughtful letters and input and feedback we've gotten. And I hope that that does continue, because you've been so responsive as the administrators to suggestions for change and things like that, that it really has been kind of a community effort. I mean, with someone going so far as to creating a new budget option. And so I hope that whatever's decided as far as the budget, that they realize that's not the end, that this is still going to be an ongoing process, and they can say, you know, this needs not being met, or a teacher can say, I'm really struggling, I need this, and know that you're all there to support them, we're all here to support them, and I think it is the right thing to do, and that we just all have to be patient.
So I was reading through all the letters of public comment, and I was particularly struck by two letters from parents of special education students. I think it was at Bridge Street, and they were speaking about how their students had really benefited from substantially separate programs, and that was where they saw the most change in their children's education. So I was wondering, I mean, I know you've done so much in looking through those public comments and responding to them, so how would you respond to that, and how have you?
So I would say the answer is methodology. You know, I think we have to start, one of the pieces that I had sent out to committee members talks about saying, if you have a student who's not performing, your presumption should be that there's something wrong with the instruction that he or she is receiving, rather than that there's something wrong with the child. So I think that sometimes students find that that methodology that's going to work for them in substantially separate classrooms, because that's what we're providing it right now. And what we're trying to do with this change by embedding special educators in the general ed classroom is say, you don't have to go to a different school or a different classroom to get that. We're going to have special educators who know how to meet your needs in the classroom where you would normally be.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Other comments, questions? Dr. Barron.
So I don't know if we're going to make a motion tonight to approve this budget or not. I know that'll come later. But you know, I'm just sitting here and I'm thinking a lot about the meeting where we had the survey of the school, the charter school parents, and the feedback that we saw, or the decision making that was sort of shown through that. And I'm thinking about it, and you know, I made my announcement that we're moving, but we spent 6 months researching towns, reading budgets, looking at curriculum, you know, finding out people who work there who I could talk to. And when I think about people looking at Northampton, and I think that this budget reflects something that would be really desirable to a lot of those families in terms of the inclusion model. But when I think about cutting the librarians or the instructional support or lack thereof for the administrators in the district, it's very lean. It would be very concerning for me as someone looking at a district and thinking about, do I want to choose the public school? Do I want to choose Hilltown or campus school, et cetera? I mean, we looked at Montessori school when we were first considering what the options would be for our kids. And I think that there sometimes is a false argument about the money piece, because I didn't see, and you mentioned that there wasn't feedback saying we should cut or we need to hold the taxes back. I think the community would support what we went forward and said, this is what's really needed. And I, you know, I'm only going to be here for, this might be my last meeting, maybe one more, but I think that that's something that the committee needs to really think about, is that we're chasing the school choice problem, but that is the world that we're living in right now. And so how do we make Northampton be the most attractive choice for families? And I think there's a lot of things in this budget that do make that happen. But I still think that there are things that make it, in some ways, an unattractive choice. And I think that's something for us all to think about.
Other comments? So we typically we schedule these meetings, this extra meeting, as is denoted on the agenda tonight. We have this budget meeting, and then the sort of the final, last possible time that you could vote on this budget would be at your next meeting in the middle of April. So the question is there more information that you feel that you need? Or do we feel that does the committee feel that we've come through this process and come to a modified wins? I don't know how many modifications we're up to now. But we've sort of come to a place where you feel comfortable about taking a vote on the budget. So I don't know what people's thoughts are on that, or whether there is additional work that you want the superintendent to do, or something additional that would take place over the next several weeks. So I guess that I'd like to hear feedback on that, or a motion. Or something. So, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I feel like I've asked Dr. Provost for a lot of information, and a lot of the inserts, I think, kind of reflect those requests, and I'm prepared to vote tonight. I feel like all of my questions have been addressed, and that if what people are concerned about is not having time, that delaying this further might not be the best in their best interest.
Okay. Yes.
I think if we delay, then we get to see Tom Baird one more time. So I think we should. But seriously, I could vote on this tonight, but it would be with a really heavy heart. I feel like for 11, probably 9 of the 11 years that my kids have been in the system, it's been cuts. And I'm sure that for many years before they got in the system, it was cuts. and you just can't, we as a community and as a country and as a state can't sustain that. And I feel like we as a committee can't sort of idly approve that a year after year after year after year, that there comes a time where we have to say no more. So I've really weighed this and racked my brain and felt terrible about having to vote for or against this budget. And I feel like, I mean, and this is separate from the sped changes, which I think are fabulous. This is just about the fact that yet again, we're losing some people, we're having to jigger things, we're not getting to add the things that aren't that expensive, that could make big differences. And I just feel like maybe over the next year, we can commit ourselves to somehow figuring out how to raise more money citywide, statewide. And I support the WINS model, the modified WINS model, but I can't support another budget after this year that contains cuts. We can't keep doing this. There comes a point where the death by a thousand cuts. And the reason we have such a great district is because our teachers sacrifice so much and our community sacrifices so much, and we've got NEF and we've got PTOs that just dig so deep to raise money for us. But there comes a time when we have to, as a school committee and as a community, say, that's enough. We're not gonna do this anymore to ourselves or to our kids. So I could vote, but it just kind of breaks my heart, frankly, to constantly be going through this process.
I just do want to voice from a student perspective. I completely agree with what Mr. Reed is saying. I know in terms of the high school and the student union, we submitted a letter and we were in a panic because the alt budget included a reduction in one of the academic teaching positions at NHS, and we were panicking over that and then realized regardless of which budget gets approved, we're still losing a position in the technology department at our high school. And it just kind of felt like no matter which option, we're losing a position and we're having reductions in our teaching staff. And that is disappointing. And I know as a student union, we grappled with that. I just wanted to completely support with what you're saying. I love this budget process that we've gone through, and it's been wonderful getting to watch. But it is disappointing as a student to kind of grapple with the fact that no matter which path you take, something's gone.
Sorry, I was going to.
I got a JD. Does
okay, yeah.
So counselor. I just had an accounting
barrister.
So I had an accounting question. So as of the WINS modified proposal, it was a net reduction from fiscal 17 of 2.74.
FTEs.
FTEs. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I understand FTEs are. They're shorthand, but so the current WINS version 3.1 version is that would change by the addition of a 1.0 sped teacher at Jackson and then the reductions of the two ASPs. So I just wanted to make sure that I had the final tally right.
So I'm not sure what your thoughts are, if you want
to. Yeah, I think if the committee is ready to take a vote, I'd be happy to move it forward. I don't think, to Mr. Reed's point and others, unfortunately, the world in which we live, we find ourselves making a decision every year sitting at this table. And I've yet to sit here when we've had a surplus and was able to add to the budget. But we've always been very thrifty and crafty in the way that we've managed not only our personnel, but the finances and the appropriation from the mayor and the city in order to create a very high level of education for our students. And I think that this year's budget is nothing less than that. I think the effort to go into looking at something that was identified once we we're looking at different ways of doing things and the identification of being able to do a more inclusionary model. I think it's something that this district is ready for, and I support the modified WINS. And so I, you know, with that, I don't know if next year, you know, you said, Mr. Reed, that you wouldn't be able to support another cut. If we can't find the money, you know, it'll be my 10th year sitting at the table, probably discussing how we can either maneuver things or make things the best it can be for our students, but it might in fact involve cuts, and I never enjoy voting on a budget that is reducing personnel. I think student-teacher contact is the most important thing that you can do in education, and making sure that it's in a ratio that is as small as it can be, so that a student, a group of students and a teacher can work in the smallest group possible for that teacher and the student experience, is what we always strive to. And I think even this model does that. Even though some of the classroom sizes are 25, we do have we have more than one educator in the classroom, and so the student to teacher ratio is different than what the size of the classroom is. So with that, I'd be happy to move the budget, move to approve the FY 2018 budget in the amount, I don't know, do I have to say the amount? Yeah, in the amount of $28,838,966. Thank you, Mayor.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, second. Further discussion on that note? Mr. Moore.
Yeah, I think I'm be really very, I think we should be really proud if we vote for, I plan to vote for this, and for the inclusion that we're putting forward here. But I think the response to, in many ways, it's what we should do anyway, but it's something we really need to do because of the budget concerns, is everybody who's participating in it. So all the parents and teachers and administrators really, in order for this to work, need to be problem solving all the time and not assuming that the budget's passed and so we all just sit back and wait for things to happen. You know, it can't be that model, you know? And be problem solving as opposed to, you know, seeing, being proved right if you thought it was gonna fail or whatever, you know? And I just sort of really encourage everybody to do that. And then I think we will be very proud of what we have made.
Any other comments or? Okay, so there's a motion that's been made and seconded to approve the proposed FY18 budget for the Northampton Public Schools. I can do a voice vote or a roll call vote, whatever people prefer. Any preference on that? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the ayes have it. The budget is unanimously adopted for FY 2018. And obviously, thank you, Dr. Provost,
thank
and Ms. Walczak, and the administrative leadership team, and to everyone, all of the parents who've been engaged in this process, and obviously to my colleagues. So in terms of new business, I would just state, I guess I would, we don't have anything specific. I would just say. That in reaction to Dr. Baird's announcement tonight, just to outline folks who are wondering what our process is, depending on when Dr. Baird, he's made the announcement, but depending on when he actually files something formally with the city clerk, that will start a 30-day clock ticking under our charter by which we will then have to the city council president and the school committee will have to work to convene a joint meeting. Ms. Fallon may remember this. And so there will have to then be a joint meeting of the school committee and the city council. I will have to talk to the council president about that, and we'll probably try to arrange it around one of our regularly scheduled meetings. So we will have then 30 days to take a vote to appoint
someone to fill out the remainder of Dr. Baird's term. So we'll keep you posted on that, and you'll, I'm sure you'll be hearing something about a potential meeting or a change to a future meeting where we may have to add that joint meeting component.
The millions who are watching, can you explain what someone would have to do exactly, who was interested?
Well, it's a little premature.
Okay.
Because technically, until such time that we can't even schedule the meeting until such time that there's been a formal resignation. The way the charter works is you can't start the process. But I can tell you from past experience, typically what's happened is people who are interested are asked to contact, you know, the city council and school committee and send a sort of a letter of interest. I think that's what happened last time. But then, you know, it's essentially an election conducted by the 20 members of the, you know, the school committee, the 19 members of the school committee and the city council have to actually have an election and figure out that process. So that's what would happen.
Thank you.
So, and Dr.
Baird, I hope you all appreciate my my effort to let you engage with some civic action. My intention would be to submit it by March 31st.
Okay. So March 31st. So again, that would give us until the end of April, roughly. So likely we would try to schedule a meeting. We'd schedule a meeting potentially around the April school committee meeting or possibly the third week in April city council meeting. We'd have to figure that out. It would probably be easier than doing that as opposed to trying to pick a third date that to try to get both bodies together. So that's something I'll have to confer with the council president. But thank you, Dr. Baird, for your service to the community. I know you're making the decision that you have to make for your family, but I've enjoyed the opportunity to serve with you and continue to serve with you for the next few days.
So, thank you.
I'd like to echo. Dr. Baird and I have a long history together. Many people probably don't know, but we started as colleagues over at East Hampton High School, where he was a math teacher and I was a Spanish teacher. He later became my superior when he became a vice principal. But we lost touch over the years, for a few years anyway, but I was very excited to hear that he's moved back to the area and became active in the Ryan Road School, and then, of course, when he became school committee member. So on behalf of the school committee and the citizens of Northampton, just once again, thank you so much for your service and good luck.
Thank you.
I want to add to that, Tom, you're an awesome guy. I've learned a lot from watching you, and I'm going to miss you. I don't know what else to say. I'm really sorry that you're moving away, and I hope you move back soon. So.
Well, I hope not for us.
Okay. So the only other announcement that I have to make is that our next our next regular school committee meeting is scheduled for April 13th at 7:15 in the JFK Community Room. With that, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstention? This concludes the meeting of the Northampton School Committee. The meeting is adjourned.